You're listening to the Chad Easty Show on demand. Good for you. Now download the KFYO app and listen live weekday afternoons, 5 to 7 p.m. Central.
Broadcasting from the great state of Texas, this is the Chad Easty Show. News and views with a Lone Star perspective. You can sound off during the show by sending Chad a text at 806-680-2790. That's 806-680-2790. Or call in at 1-800-687-0790. Now, here's Chad Easty.
Good evening, Lubbock, Amarillo, Abilene, Wichita Falls, Midland, Odessa, Dallas, Fort Worth, down in Houston, over in El Paso, and anywhere else, inside or outside the great state of Texas, wherever you may be listening on this Tuesday, July 23rd. 2024. Welcome into the program. A very busy show, as always. It's never a slow news day around here. Have you noticed that? It's one of those when I first got into talk radio, even up until just a few years ago, people were always asking me, "Do you have stuff to talk about? Is there enough to talk about every single day? Is there something?" Yeah, there's always something going on. There's always someone making news somewhere and always topics for us to discuss. That's for sure. 1-800-687-0790. That's 1-800-687-0790. The first voice you hear from when you dial in, that's Nick. We'll check in with him in just a bit. We do have Marc Lotter, who will be joining us coming up here in just a little bit with a America First. We'll talk with him about everything going on in the Trump-Vance campaign and also the Harris question mark campaign as we move forward. We've got some new polling numbers coming out regarding Kamala Harris and the race with Trump. We'll get into that. And possible VP picks as well. So we've got all of that to get into. We've also got some news out of Lubbock and Abilene that we'll be getting into, as well as it is budget season. Can't forget about budget season. You know, all eyes and ears have been on the circus happening in Washington, D.C., but we cannot forget about the locals and what they are putting into the budgets and tax rates and everything else. So we continue to take a look at that as news comes out on that front. Of course, we want to hear from you today on really any of the issues with the Secret Service Director. She resigned. She decided, well, I'm done. I'm out. Things aren't going to work out well for me, it seems. And so the Secret Service Director out, resigning today. We'll get into that a little bit. A smart move on her part to resign. She should have been fired, but it said resigning from the U.S. Secret Service after she admits one of the worst letdowns in Secret Service history. And so we'll be getting into that today on the program. Again, want to hear from you. You can text in at 806-680-2790. That's 806-680-2790. And you can, of course, give us a call at any time. 1-800-687-0790. The first voice you hear from when you dial in today, he's ready to go for winter. Nick, the first voice you hear from when you dial in. You doing okay, Nick?
I'm doing okay.
Yeah.
It's a Tuesday, start of the week, kind of. the end of Tuesday. So we're almost halfway through the week.
Yes.
Which is a big milestone. Something I always look forward to. Mondays are the worst. Tuesdays are
Yeah, you're the Monday is the worst type of guy.
I'm on that train.
You don't like it. You don't like Mondays.
It's like your alarm clock. It starts your week. It's there. You can't move it. You got to get up. You got to do stuff. You got to go to work.
What is your favorite day of the week? Do you have a favorite?
Weekday or weekend day?
Whatever. Okay. Just day of the week.
I'm going to say, I'll be cliche.
Yeah?
I'd say between Friday, Saturday.
You're going to go That's Friday?
Probably.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, the end of the week.
Yeah.
Usually, you know, you have a nice smooth weekend. Nice transition from work to, business to pleasure.
Yeah. So Friday at about 7:10 p.m., that's your happiest.
Usually between 30 minutes and an hour after the show ends. after that point, I'm, okay. Yeah, that's relaxation begins.
Yeah. Good to know.
And, the thermostat goes down. You know,
how's that going?
Oh, it's still going.
Oh, good.
It's I got home yesterday, 79 degrees.
Hey, there you go.
Yeah. So it's going down a little.
It's out of the 80s.
That's right. That's right. Now it may be 80 right now. I don't know. Probably.
It's like Christmas morning. You show up and you have no idea what it's at.
It's a fun little game I play.
Yeah.
Every day I wake up. Am I going to be boiling? or am I going to be comfortable? I don't know.
Oh well. I don't know what to say.
You don't need to say anything.
At this point, it's been a month, and you're very patient. Very patient.
I am. People say that about me, and I appreciate that.
Yeah. Yeah. Now your fiance she's like that. It needs to get fixed.
Oh yeah. Yeah. Well, so her reasoning is fair.
She doesn't want to live in 80 degree.
Well, it's that, but also you know we have two big dogs. And my fiance are both gone most of the day, I suppose. Yeah. Around the afternoon. We're gone both in the afternoon. So there's quite a few hours there where the dogs are, you know, in their crates at home. So we don't really want to stash them away. And they are in the warmest room in the house. Their crates are.
Poor dogs. So
they're in the warmest room, which already is a little bit warmer than normal. And add on 85 in the house, so it's probably close to 90 in that room.
Poor dogs.
Poor dogs, poor us. It's
I feel bad. I feel worse for the dogs.
Hey, that's fair. That's fair. Yeah. So, we don't want them, you know, we draw the line with the dogs, right?
Yeah.
You know, we draw, we can take anything.
Yeah.
We're tough.
But don't mess with the dogs.
Bring the dogs in there?
Mm-mm. Yeah.
We're going to get that looked at, so... We'll see. I think I said yesterday we're waiting on a part to be delivered.
That's right, yes.
So hopefully this week we will see some lower temperatures. We'll see.
All right. 806-680-2790. You can send in your thoughts on the text line. You can also get in at 1-800-687-0790. Let's see. Pat from Lawton. Tuesday is a good day because today is today. Tomorrow is tomorrow. Today. Okay. All right. You can send in your thoughts on the text line, 806-680-2790. That's 806-680-2790. One of the other big headlines today, the feds had discovered transcripts of Biden chats with the biographer. The Justice Department told federal judge late yesterday that it's located transcripts that it previously denied having. Oh! Of President Joe Biden's talks with a biographer that played a role in the recently completed criminal investigation into Biden's handling of classified material. In the wake of the report, a special counsel, Robert Hur, issued in February that described Biden as, quote, well-meaning elderly man with a poor memory. The Justice Department has been swamped with Freedom of Information Act requests and lawsuits demanding access to various records related to Hur's probe. Some of the requests came from news outlets, while others originated with conservative groups apparently trying to obtain information that could reinforce doubts about Biden's mental acuity and fitness for the presidency. It's unclear whether his exit from the race will affect the handling of HERS material by the Justice Department, which has argued the release of audio of Biden's interview with her would violate the president's privacy, lead to potential abuse such as deepfakes, and deter other witnesses from agreeing to be recorded in interviews. So they just magically found new information and new documents. Amazing how that happened just after Biden drops out of the race. When we come back, we're scheduled to visit with Marc Lotter here on the Chad Hastie Show. Looking forward to that conversation. We'll be right back.
Song, song of the South, sweet potato pie and a shut my mouth.
The Titan of Texas Talk Radio, Chad Hastie.
Talking with newsmakers and about the issues that matter to you. The Chad Hastie Show, weekdays from 5 to 7 p.m. Chad's show is also digital with the Chad Hastie Show podcast. The Chad Hastie Show podcast can be downloaded on Apple Podcasts, Amazon Music, Spotify, and the Radio On Demand page at KFYO.com. The Chad Hastie Show, all across Texas during your drive home, weekdays from 5 to 7 p.m.
Clay Travis and Buck Sexton.
Wednesday edition, Clay Travis, Buck Sexton show. The Kamala Harris unbelievable presidential campaign is off and running. What is the latest? We will break it down for you. Plus, reports that Joe Biden will address the nation finally after a week's absence. Do we expect him to be able to or not? We will discuss all that more. Wednesday edition, Clay and Buck.
Clay Travis and Buck Sexton, tomorrow morning at 11.
Welcome back to the Chad Hastie Show. Appreciate you being out there. You can text in 806-680-2790. Joining us on the phones right now, we just spoke with them just last week. Now we get to visit with them again with the America First Policy Institute, the Chief of Communications, former Director of Strategic Communications for the Trump-Pence 2020 campaign, Marc Lotter, joining us on the Chad Hastie Show. Welcome back, Marc. How are you today?
I'm doing great. How are you, Chad?
Doing fantastic. Well, the last time I spoke with you, it was a Trump versus Biden campaign. Now,
what, like a year ago?
It feels like it. Now it's a Trump, most likely Kamala Harris campaign. What is that? What do you think this means for, I guess, the next 56 days before, I believe that's when Pennsylvania starts to early vote. And I mean, it's coming. It's going to come up quickly when people start casting ballots. So what does this change at the top of the ticket mean for the campaign?
Well, I mean, first off, I mean, Kamala Harris better change her poll position, because Democrats will throw you overboard, you know, for politics. And so who knows if she's going to be the nominee. So-called defenders of democracy have no problem ditching democracy when it's not convenient for their grip on power. But look, it doesn't matter who is on the Democrat line. The policies aren't going to change.
Right.
It's not like Kamala Harris, who's against fracking, was a co-author of the Green New Deal, is suddenly going to come out and say, drill, baby, drill. She wants an open border. She's the border czar. For 3.5 years, she could have done something about it. Now, like, now she owns that. So everything we hate about Joe Biden transfers to Kamala Harris, because she's got the same horrible policies.
Well, and maybe even it should maybe even a little bit more, because she's further to the left than Joe Biden was. I mean, in 2020, the Democrats tried to, at least they tried, to position Joe as the moderate compared to Kamala Harris. She's from deep blue California. It would make sense that she's further to the left on many issues, and just judging by her public comments, she's pretty far to the left.
Oh, no. I mean, Joe Biden was just owned by the squad. She is, She is the squad.
Yeah.
I mean, don't let it for a minute just forget here. She raised money to bail out the not peaceful protesters during the BLM riots. And now one of them is actually charged with murder up in Minnesota. She actually let a gang member off of the death penalty who killed a police officer. I mean, this is a woman who, you know, but thank goodness. I mean, obviously, she wants to be commander-in-chief. She explained the situation in Ukraine as Ukraine is a country that's small, that's next to Russia, that's big.
Well, I mean, you know, I guess.
I mean, it's not wrong.
Yeah, I guess she's accurate on that, sure. When it comes to the I mean, obviously the Trump campaign, they had a great convention. Almost just about everybody says it was a great convention for Republicans. Now you've got the Democrats who are they're still in a little bit of a disarray moment, but they are at least it looks surrounding Kamala Harris. The message from the Trump campaign, is it, do you think it needs to be going after her personally, going after policy, a little bit of both? What are we likely to see from the Trump campaign moving forward?
Well, I think first and foremost, you know, she's going to try to reintroduce herself to the American people, the same person who talked about the issues with AI, is that, well, it's a two-letter word. Yeah. She's going to try to reintroduce herself. So we've absolutely had to dump about $100 million on her so the American people know what a radical she actually is. I mean, this is a woman who doesn't support Israel, who cheerleaded for the pro-Hamas terrorist campus rioters who burned American flags, hung Hamas flags on college campuses, and that's who she really is. But we also have to remember the policy, because a lot of people are just going to gravitate toward, well, what's best for me? Well, let's think about it. You know, she's part of that administration that led to sky-high inflation, gas prices, the open border, the wars that are raging. She is soft on crime. And so everything that matters to the American people, Kamala Harris is even worse than Joe Biden.
Yeah. I've seen this pop up a few different times. There was, I guess, a memo that went out about polling today. You've worked with, the former president, a lot, on this and messaging and communications. If Kamala Harris gets a poll bump, which the Trump campaign apparently believes she will get one, and the news media is going to fawn over her, we know that. How long do you believe, will this be a short-term bump, do you think?
Yeah, I mean, I think she's going to get a bump. There's no question about that. And I think it will start to see it manifest itself here probably the next week or so. Mm-hmm. And then it will culminate shortly after the Democratic National Convention. And so for the next month, the polls will continue to improve for her. But as more and more people get to know her, see where her positions are, listen to her laugh inappropriately when she shouldn't be laughing, I think in the campaign expects that it's going to gravitate back to where it was, which is she's more unpopular than Joe Biden was.
Yeah.
And her policies are worse than Joe Biden's were. So we will probably, I would say, around the 1st of September, around Labor Day, be back at the same position or roughly the same position where we were in the swing states. But the one thing I would remind everyone, the final Real Clear Politics average in 2020 had Joe Biden beating Donald Trump by 7.5 points. The final national margin was 4.5 points. The reality was it came back to 43,000 votes in three states. If Kamala Harris is not up 4 to 5 points nationally, she's losing.
Yeah. Good thoughts by Marc Lotter with the America First Policy Institute. Mark, thanks for giving us a call today. We appreciate the insight. And like I said last time, I'm sure we'll be visiting once again very, very soon. And who knows who the top of the ticket may be at that point the next time we visit.
No, can I just have a weekend off, please?
It could be Pete Buttigieg. You never know. Hey, Mark, thank you very much. Have a great weekend.
Talk to you soon, Chad.
All right. That's Marc Lotter with the America First Policy Institute. We'll actually have someone on with the RNC tomorrow, and we'll probably be visiting with campaign folks leading all the way up to the election. You can text in 806-680-2790. That's 806-680-2790. Let's see, one texter. Will crazy Kamala be impeached? How will it affect her fraudulent run as president? Should she be in prison for letting the illegals invade our country? She won't be impeached. No. That's not going to happen. And, will she face a barrage of attack ads since she was the border czar and did nothing on the border, did nothing about it, did nothing about the illegal immigration coming across the border. She will have to face that. Absolutely. And she'll have to face Trump in a debate at some point. We'll be right back.
Call in to the Chad Hastie Show at 1-800-687-0790. The Chad Hastie Show, broadcasting on the Texas Town Square Media Network.
On the road with Mr. Rhodes.
Hey, here's the shocker. Cars are bigger than people. So if you're behind the wheel, be careful. Those crosswalk stripes, yeah, they aren't left over from National Painted Street like a zebra day. They mean you need to stop for people in crosswalks and yield the right-of-way when turning at intersections. And no looking at phones, photos, texts, emails, or holding your jeans or where that nickel fell. Oh, and please, slow down. Sound advice, mixed in with professional sound effects.
Be safe, drive smart. A message from TxDOT.
Ever tried balancing a dozen eggs in one hand while hopping on one foot? Or maybe juggling cats while riding the unicycle? Sounds ridiculous, right? But guess what? That's exactly what texting while driving is like. Your human brain only has the capacity to focus on one thing at a time. So when you're behind the wheel, give driving your undivided attention.
Don't drive distracted. A message brought to you by the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration, Project Yellow Light, and the Ad Council.
The news and talk of West Texas. News Talk 95.1 and 790 KFYO. Don't you forget about Chad. At Chad Hastie Radio. On Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And on your radio. Now, back to the Chad Hastie Show.
All right, welcome back to the Chad Hastie Show. You can send in your thoughts on the text line, 806-680-2790. That's 806-680-2790. You can weigh in, sound off on any of the topics of the day, any of the topics that we'll be getting into. This is from Axios yesterday. Last night this came out. Biden doubted Harris's election chances. President Biden hesitated to drop his reelection campaign in part because he and his senior aides worry that Vice President Kamala Harris is not up to taking on Donald Trump. That, according to three Biden aides familiar with recent talks about his plans Biden ultimately decided to withdraw under pressure from the party and endorsed Harris, but his private anxieties reflect the broader questions among some Democrat leaders about Harris as their nominee this November. This week will be critical for Harris to prove doubters wrong as she moves quickly to try and clear the field of potential challengers for the Democrat nomination. So far, she's been able to. She's been able to raise money and get the endorsements that she needs. But there are still Democrats who are unsure about her. In fact, the New York Times had a piece out that Kamala Harris was not the best to take on Donald Trump. A collection of New York Times journalists believes that the vice president and the presumptive Democrat presidential nominee, Kamala Harris, is the least electable candidate Democrats could put up against Trump. After Joe Biden announced that he would not seek a second term in the White House on Sunday, the Times enlisted 8 writers and columnists to grade 10 potential candidates on both how electable and exciting they would be. Although she finished 5th in the latter category, she finished dead last in the former and most important one. On a 10-point scale, Harris was rated a 4.6, was one of only 2 candidates to have an average of their electability scores fall below 5. The other was Gavin Newsom at a 4.9. Josh Morrow wrote, she has demonstrated no appeal to swing voters, and she cannot run away from the Biden-Harris record on inflation and immigration. Another writer with the New York Times wrote, she's a mediocre politician from a deep blue state with a low national approval rating. She may find a way to win, but she would be nobody's top choice if she were not the top choice of the president. Relief at Biden's exit will generate a lot of professed enthusiasm, but it'll be fake. Even Biden fans see Harris as one of the weakest elements of his administration, noted Pamela Paul. A country desperate for change would bristle at that feeling that once again, a real Democratic choice is being sidelined in favor of the most deserving insider. Harris is a fundamentally weak candidate. She fizzled out early in her first presidential run and floundered in the vice presidency. Now, there's some polling numbers that are coming out. And one of them, a new national poll, this out of Reuters, she leads Donald Trump nationally 44% to 42%. The new poll conducted Monday and Tuesday followed both the Republican National Convention and Biden's announcement on Sunday that he was leaving the race and endorsing Harris. Harris, whose campaign says she secured the Democrat nomination, led Trump 44% to 42% in a national poll, the difference a 3-point margin of error, essentially tied. Harris and Trump were tied at 44% in a July poll. Trump led by 1 point in a July 1st through 2nd poll with the same margin of error. A pollster with Trump's campaign has played down any polling showing an increase in Harris's support, arguing she was likely to see a temporary rise in popularity because of the widespread media coverage of her new candidacy. And didn't I tell you they were just going to love Kamala Harris? Oh, the media love. They're not running any old clips of Kamala. They're just talking about how great she is and how she's energizing the party. The Democrat Party had nowhere to go but to be energized. They were dead. They were dealing with a candidate who can barely walk. And now they've gone to Kamala Harris, who, you know what? A lot of people forget just how far left she is. Republicans and the Trump campaign are going to have to do a really good job at reminding the American people of just who Kamala Harris is. And I think they will. And I think she will be a damaged candidate, a flawed candidate, pretty soon. But she's going to enjoy a honeymoon period right now because the Democrats are very excited that they don't have, weak-headed Bernies. at the top of the ticket, and that they have somebody who is quote-unquote youthful. The Democrats are excited about it. Now, there are also a lot of Democrats who are very worried that she's a horrible campaigner. She laughs at inappropriate times, and she's not very bright. When it comes to the national issues, she's not very bright, and she is somebody who is very, very, very far to the left. Let's see, another texter. Do you think if Trump wins the election, Democrats will try to set up a shadow government to oppose him? No, I don't think they'll do that. I think they will call the election into question. If Trump goes on to win, folks, there's a very, I mean, I already thought that you would probably see some political violence out there if Trump wins. If Trump wins now, not only will the media lose their minds, they will also push this narrative that America is racist. That America is racist, misogynist, and you will see protests. You will see, you'll see some bad things going on in the days and weeks after the election. And you'll probably see the Democrats say that it's an invalid election, just like they did in 2016. Yeah, when Hillary tried to say that the election was not on the up and up, you'll see more talk like that coming from the Democrats. 806-680-2790. When we come back, your phone calls, your text messages, and much more, and we'll get into some local issues.
The big stuff. Who do you think you are? It's the big stuff.
The Chad Hasty Show can be heard all over West Texas, weekdays from 5 to 7 p.m. Tune in on News Talk 95.1 and 790 KFYO in Lubbock. News Talk 940 in Amarillo. News Talk 94.7 and 1470 KYYW in Abilene. And in Wichita Falls on News Talk 96.3 and 1290. The Chad Hasty Show. Make it a part of your drive home. Weekdays from 5 to 7 p.m.
Clay Travis and Buck Sexton.
Wednesday edition, Clay Travis, Buck Sexton Show. The Kamala Harris unbelievable presidential campaign is off and running. What is the latest? We will break it down for you. Plus, reports that Joe Biden will address the nation finally after a week's absence. Do we expect him to be able to or not? We will discuss all that more Wednesday edition, Clay and Buck.
Clay Travis and Buck Sexton, tomorrow morning at 11.
Welcome back to the Chad Hasty Show. Appreciate you being out there. Let's see. Let's get into a couple of local stories. For those of you in the Lubbock area, Donald Trump Jr. expected to be in Lubbock at the Lubbock area Republican Women's Pink Elephant Gala. That's going to be coming up on August 22nd. If you'd like to get more information, get tickets, all that kind of good stuff, it's going to be at 6 p.m. on August 22nd. You can get more information at larw.org. larw.org if you'd like to get tickets and see Trump Jr., Donald Trump Jr., speak at the Pink Elephant Dinner. That's going to be happening on August 22nd. Again, put that on your calendar, should be a good time. And let's see. Another story, this out of KCBD, the Lubbock County Commissioner's Court, Oh, this is nice. Yeah, Commissioner's Court approving raises for 16 people who hold offices in Lubbock County. Some court members prepared to provide a 5% raise. Others say they would not go above 2%. Monday, the court unanimously agreed to add the raise to its budget. County Judge Curtis Parrish said he plans to give his raise, which is worth about $2,500, back to the general fund. It's still your money that they're taking from you and giving to elected officials who knew exactly how much they were going to make when they ran for office. They knew exactly how much the job paid when they ran for office, and we got to keep giving pay raises to the elected officials who are making just a fine amount. They're not struggling. They're not hurting compared to many of their constituents. They're not hurting. They're just going to give each other a pay raise. And I love this idea. Well, I'll just give my pay raise to the general fund. You're still taking people's money. You're taking people's money and using it for whatever you want to, which, okay, you're going to give it to the general fund. Well, that doesn't mean a damn thing. Doesn't mean you're going to spend it any better. Doesn't mean you're going to use it wisely. Doesn't mean you're going to put it towards anything good. And Abilene City Council, they're talking budgets and considering raising property taxes. The Abilene City Council, they met on Monday to discuss the budget hearing. The City Council has proposed plans they want to implement, but that raises the question for many citizens: how do you pay for it? KTXS spoke with one citizen who said she feels uneasy about the proposed budget plans. Well, the revenue they use from our hard-earned money, I'm just concerned that we're not saving up, and we're not been paying. Now we're going to have to put more debt because we haven't been taking care of the things like libraries. As part of the council's plan to save money, they voted last month to demolish two rec centers at the same time. It was also proposed at the budget hearing not to move forward with pickleball courts. Oh, no. They're not moving forward with pickleball. There's not going to be any pickleball in Abilene. Well, we know there's a lot of private entities that are putting in pickleball courts, the mayor said. We definitely want quality of life for our residents, but the budget shortfall, the budget deficit with our sales tax, we just felt it's something that we didn't really need to spend money on this year. One idea that was discussed was a property rate increase for residents. The mayor said if approved, the new property tax rate will be about $5 annually based on the average household of $157,000. Raising the tax rate will allow the Abilene Police Department to bring in 5 new police officers to increase public safety. Quote, their salary is recurring. See, they always go back to elected officials. They always go back to this idea that, well, you know, if we're not able to do this, it's going to impact public safety. You know, is there anywhere else you can cut? Is there anywhere else you can say, oh, well, instead of not funding these 5 officers, maybe you don't find some other project that's going on in Abilene? Well, yeah, next item on the agenda, the permanent building of a tech stadium, Forest Service Base, at the Abilene Regional Airport. The mayor said the project will cost the city $2 million. Another $20 million will be funded by the state. And again, I think they just built a dog park in Abilene. So, you know, no pickleball, but they've got the dog park. And taxes are going to go up. So these are the things you got to be paying attention to. And showing up to council meetings, voicing your opinion, whether it's council meetings, whether it's county commissioners meetings, you better show up. Texter, Curtis Parrish better save that money because he's going to have to either pay his taxes or move. That's right. But I love this idea, too. that, this was unanimously passed, this vote to increase people's pay was unanimous. And I just look at it and go, are you guys not reading the room? People want you to stop spending money. If there's a county official out there who has decided that they don't want to, either continue their service, and this is supposed to be a service, if they don't want to serve Lubbock County and the taxpayers because they're not getting paid enough, then they can step aside. There will be somebody to run for office. I can promise you that. If there's a county commissioner who looks at the current pay and goes, ooh, I don't know if I want to be a county commissioner, not at that pay, then step aside, resign, and I'm sure we'll find somebody else to run. But this idea that we just got to increase everybody's pay, even though they knew what the job paid when they ran for it, just got to give everybody an automatic increase. This is why people don't trust what's happening with the Lubbock County Commissioners. We'll be right back.
The Chad Hastie Show, a presentation of the Texas Town Square Media Network. The views and opinions expressed during the Chad Hastie Show are not necessarily the views of this station staff, management, advertisers, or Town Square Media. Broadcasting from the great state of Texas, this is the Chad Hastie Show. News and views with a Lone Star perspective. You can sound off during the show by sending Chad a text at 806-680-2790. That's 806-680-2790. Or call in at 1-800-687-0790. Now, here's Chad Hastie.
Welcome back to the Chad Hastie Show, final hour of the program. Hope you're having a wonderful evening. Hopefully you made it home or you're on your way to pick up some dinner tonight. Maybe on your way back from the office. Maybe you're still at work. I know Nick, he's still at work. I see him. He's right over there. He's still working. And maybe that's you as well. We appreciate you inviting us in and joining you this evening. 806-680-2790. That's 806-680-2790. Give us a call at 1-800-687-0790. Texter weighing in a little bit ago. On the news this morning, Amarillo Democrat said, it's so exciting we get to vote for a woman and vote blue no matter who. Jay Lynn says, that's ignorant justification for voting, but that's just my personal opinion. Let's not forget that there are going to be people who vote for Kamala Harris strictly because she's a woman. I mean, there will be people out there who vote for her strictly because of that. There will be people who vote for her because of her race. There will be people, I mean, we've seen this before in the world of politics. This is not new. There will be people who vote for her because she's younger than Trump, younger than Biden. You know, I keep seeing, and I touched on this a little bit yesterday, that there are all these, folks on Facebook who were just, and social media who just go, oh, there's no way. There's no way Kamala Harris can beat Donald Trump. That is the worst way of thinking. Kamala Harris, if she is indeed the nominee forget about the policies, okay? Because the media, they're not going to talk about the policies. They're not going to talk about how crazy she is. They're not going to talk about how she's a far leftist. They're going to say that she's the future of America. The news media overall is going to fall in love with Kamala Harris, and they're going to be gushing about Kamala Harris just like they were about Barack Obama. Now, the news media went after Kamala Harris when she ran for the Democrat nomination because the game was set. It was going to be Joe Biden who got the nomination, and Kamala Harris was a horrible candidate, and they called her out for being a horrible candidate. They will not say that about her this go-around. They will not say that she's a horrible candidate. Not unless she really, really, really screws up. So this is not going to be a slam dunk for Donald Trump. I hope it is. I hope that the map continues to expand for him. But there are going to be a lot of dumb masses that are voters who are going to vote for Kamala Harris just because she's younger, because she's cooler, she's hipper. Because she's a woman and she's the first. She'll be the first. She'll be historic. And that has sway over some people who cast a ballot in the United States. They don't care about the policy. They don't care about how she's voted. They don't care about her past statements. There are some people who just do not care about any of that. So again, don't think that this is just going to be a runaway win for Donald Trump. It should be. But this is a party, again, talking about the Democrats that just threw their nominee overboard. The sitting president of the United States, they just tossed overboard because they were afraid they were going to lose. They will do anything to stay in power. They will do anything at all to stay in power. 806-680-2790. Now, something interesting popped up earlier today. And it was this report, and it really got started off of Twitter or X. Black Lives Matter. You would think they'd be very happy over at Black Lives Matter about Kamala Harris, but not so much. Black Lives Matter demanding the DNC host a virtual primary. Black Lives Matter demanded on Tuesday that the Democrat National Committee immediately host an informal virtual snap primary across the nation prior to the DNC convention in August, just hours after Kamala Harris secured enough delegates to win the nomination. In a statement, Black Lives Matter called on the Democrat Party leaders to allow participation in the nomination of the presidential candidate instead of leaving it to party delegates. Quote, the current political landscape is unprecedented, with President Biden stepping aside in a manner never seen before. The moment calls for decisive action to protect the integrity of our democracy and the voices of black voters. Statement by Black Lives Matter interrupted a steady drumbeat of left-leaning voices and groups that have vowed support to Harris after Biden endorsed her on Sunday. The BLM leader told Reuters, we're not actually saying no to Kamala Harris. We're saying yes to having a process, yes to having people being, black people having able to say, have the ability to weigh in. On social media, the Black Lives Matter Twitter account was saying that the process is not fair. So very interesting. 806-680-2790. That's 806-680-2790. Kevin Lubbock, weighed in. I heard an EMT on the ground in Vegas that leaked that Joe may have had a mini stroke. There were a lot of things going around on social media. You got to be very careful with social media. And again, I don't know. I don't have any, I've got no facts on any of this stuff. But there were reports last night that you had this one reporter, I'm not going to name any names, who was saying that, you know, that basically the same thing, that Joe had had all these mini strokes or a mini heart attack, and that Joe was dead. And you have to be very careful with what pops up on social media. A lot of things will just pop up and people go with it. And the White House really has been bad because no one has seen Joe for the last week. So a lot of things get, a lot of rumors and a lot of conspiracy theories get out there. I don't know. I'm sure his health right now is not very good. But I have seen nothing that says, yes, he had a stroke somewhere. But obviously, his health is not in a place that the White House wants to admit. That's just the simple truth of the matter. They've been lying to the American public for years. So who really knows? It's very possible that he had a stroke. It's possible that he's just been sick with COVID. It's possible that he was just scared of being out in public. It's possible that he just wanted to get away from people. It's possible that he's embarrassed. I don't know. That's the problem when you have a White House that continuously lies to the American people about the health and well-being of the president. Another texter. They will vote just because she's not Donald Trump, which is why he lost the last election. Well, there were going to be a lot of people who were probably going to stay home and not vote if it was Biden versus Trump. I'm telling you, the Biden versus Trump campaign is what we really needed. It would have been the best campaign for Donald Trump. I still think he can beat Kamala Harris. Harris, again, is a horrible campaigner. But facing Biden, boy, that would have been a gift. Another texter, some people shouldn't be allowed to vote. I'm with you. I'm with you on that. 806-680-2790. When we come back, your phone calls and texts and much more.
The Titan of Texas Talk Radio. Chad Hasty.
Talking with newsmakers and about the issues that matter to you. The Chad Hasty Show, weekdays from 5 to 7 p.m. Chad's show is also digital with the Chad Hasty Show podcast. The Chad Hasty Show podcast can be downloaded on Apple Podcasts, Amazon Music, Spotify, and the Radio On Demand page at KFYO.com. The Chad Hasty Show, all across Texas during your drive home, weekdays from 5 to 7 p.m.
Clay Travis and Buck Sexton.
Wednesday edition, Clay Travis, Buck Sexton show. The Kamala Harris unbelievable presidential campaign is off and running. What is the latest? We will break it down for you. Plus, reports that Joe Biden will address the nation finally after a week's absence. Do we expect him to be able to or not? We will discuss all that more. Wednesday edition, Clay and Buck.
Clay Travis and Buck Sexton, tomorrow morning at 11.
Welcome back. Chad Hasty Show. Greg in Missouri weighing in. I'll continue to support the Trump-Vance ticket. We'll hope for a win. I'm concerned about the down ticket because I feel she'll energize the party. If we lose the House, not win the Senate, the results will be just as devastating. Remember, you got to win the White House. And look, obviously you want to win the House and the Senate and the White House. You want to win all three. But really, you've got to win the White House if you want to really start turning things around and stopping some of the crazy liberal ideas. I'm not as worried about completely losing the House right now. We'll see how some of this shakes out over the next few weeks. She's definitely energizing the party. And there will be a lot of races that do close and get close because of that. But I do think in the weeks after the Democrat convention, I think people are going to learn more about who she is when she's on the campaign trail, things that are said, things that she says in the debate, and I think their eyes will be open. Here's an audio clip of Kamala Harris, not all of her greatest hits, but just some of her different things that she has said, different ideas that she's put out there in a little under 2 minutes here.
This election in November is going to be about literally our health and whether we live or die.
Thank you, guys. And my pronouns are she, her, and hers.
She, her, and hers. Mine, too.
So I decided I was going to start prosecuting parents for truancy. What else do we know about this population, 18 through 24? They are stupid. They make really bad decisions.
Do you believe that Americans should have the right to vote at age 16?
I'm really interested in having that conversation.
Convicted, in prison, like the Boston Marathon bomber, on death row, people who are convicted of sexual assault, they should be able to vote?
I think we should have that conversation.
She thinks we should do away with the Electoral College. Do you agree with that?
I think that I'm open to the discussion. I am prepared to get rid of the filibuster to pass a Green New Deal.
But would you support changing the dietary guidelines? The food pyramid. What people
yes.
are
yes.
To reduce red meat specifically.
Yes, I would.
So would you ban offshore drilling?
Yes.
Do you ban plastic straws?
I think we should.
Assault weapons right. that are already in circulation. What do you do about those?
We have to have a buyback program, and I support a mandatory buyback program.
Kamala Harris calling the attack an attempted modern-day lynching.
Which tweet? What tweet?
About Jussie Smollett.
So I will say this about that case. I think that the facts are still unfolding.
Senator, do you have any comments on Jussie Smollett? Do you have any comments about it?
Can I have a comment on Smollett's case, please?
Yeah, so some of just a little taste of what Kamala Harris has to say while she's out on the campaign trail. She's open to a lot of discussions, getting rid of the Electoral College. She's open to that. She's open to 16-year-olds being able to vote, even though she says that young people are stupid. By the way, there's one poll that shows young people very energized by Kamala Harris and very excited about Kamala Harris's campaign. I wonder if they know that she believes they're stupid. 806-680-2790. One texter saying her being a horrible campaigner won't matter. Biden beat Trump, barely campaigned at all. Just like you said, the media will dollar up, do everything they can do to cover up and hide her shortcomings. They fooled half the country for 4 years on Biden because they know half the country doesn't pay attention. It'll be a close election. Also, wouldn't be surprised To drum up more media excitement, Joe steps down before the election and she becomes president. People keep calling for him to do so. Watch what you wish for. Listen, I don't think it's a good idea. I'm torn on this, what's right for the country versus what's right for the election coming up. What's right for the country is for Joe Biden to resign. But I'm not for Kamala Harris taking over as president. Because if I were Kamala Harris and I took over as president of the United States for the next 50 days, I would, not everything that Joe Biden has done. She's not going to change everything, but she would go in, if she were smart, and if her team was smart, they would go in and they would fire Mayorkas. They would go in and try to do everything they could do to secure the border in the next 50 days just to take arguments off the table. And for Kamala Harris to go, look at me, look what I can do. And you go and vote for me. This is what I got done just in 30 to 40 days. Guess what I can do in 4 years. So it is definitely a double-edged sword. If you're someone who believes that Joe should go and we elevate Kamala Harris to the presidency, because it can absolutely, absolutely backfire on Republicans if that were to happen. Just like this early debate. Listen, folks, the Democrats played this flawlessly. Think about if there had not been an early debate. Think about if this debate that happened a couple of weeks ago, if Trump would have said no to the debate. Do you think Biden would be out of the race right now? No. There's no way, because the media would be able to protect him. There would be no debate until after the convention. I'm telling you, the Democrats have played this perfectly. And if you're going to say, hey, get rid of Joe, install Kamala Harris as the president, if she were smart, there would be moves that she could make that could really fire up some people in the country. We'll be right back.
The Chad Hasty Show, weekdays 5 to 7 p.m. Sound off during the show by sending Chad a text at 806-680-2790. Today's markets from the Texas Department of Ag.
Howdy, neighbors. Texas feeder catalogs reporting prices steady to $7 lower. Cattle futures were up. August live cattle futures up 83 cents, closing 183.93. August feeder cattle futures up 80 cents to close at 256.40. July cotton futures up, closed at 70.13 a pound. July wheat futures up 2 pennies to close at 5.72. July corn up a dime to close at $4. And July soybean futures up 20 cents, closing $11.17 a bushel. July soybean meal futures up $6.80, close at $343.60 per ton. July Class 3 milk futures up 20 cents, close at $19.97 a hundred. August crude oil futures down 34 cents, close at $79.95 a barrel. And the Dow Jones is up 130 points to close at 40,417. And that's Market Roundup from the Texas Department of Agriculture. I'm your commissioner, Sid Miller. And remember, friends, Texas agriculture matters. Sold.
The news and talk of West Texas. News Talk 95.1 and 790 KFYO. You're listening to The Chad Hasty Show.
All right, welcome back to the Chad Hasty Show. By the way, there's some reporting going on out there that the Secret Service urging the Trump campaign not to hold any more outdoor rallies. large-scale outdoor rallies. Not sure if that means forever or if they're just saying don't do it. That's not a good idea. So that's some reporting that's been out there just recently. 806-680-2790. That's 806-680-2790. You can weigh in on the text line and bring up any topic that you'd like to. Let's see some other stories out there. NBC News, oh, they're very upset. GOP Rep Tim Burchette calls Kamala Harris a DEI vice president. The Tennessee Republican also used the initialism for diversity, equity, and inclusion in describing the Secret Service director, saying that she's a DEI horror story. He blasted Kamala Harris in a social media post Monday, calling her a DEI vice president, using the diversity, equity, and inclusion term. The media propped up this president, lied to the American people for 3 years, and dumped him for our DEI vice president, also referred to Harris as a DEI hire, in a brief interview Monday telling CNN that the 2020 campaign candidate Joe Biden said he was going to hire a black female for vice president. Quote, what about white females? What about any other group, Burchette said. Biden said at a March 2020 Democrat debate that he'd choose a female running mate but did not mention race or ethnicity. He actually did. There's a CNN story. It's amazing that they don't go back into the archives on CNN and see their own stories that are out there on CNN where they had reported that Joe Biden did say that he was going to be looking for a black female for vice president. In fact, he said it on numerous occasions. Everyone knew at that point it was going to be Kamala Harris who was going to be his pick. She was absolutely a DEI hire. He had brought up that it was that he had said even during a campaign event, or maybe it was during an interview, that the his campaign and his White House would be very diverse and equitable. Well, what do you think that means? That's DEI. Biden announced Sunday he was dropping re-election bid. He endorsed Harris for president the very next day. Yeah, another texter about Black Lives Matter. Yeah, they're saying that the Democrats are the party of hypocrites for installing Kamala Harris and that we are not a dictatorship. Senate GOP plots new attacks on Kamala Harris instead of Axios. The National Republican Senatorial Committee urging candidates to hit the vice president for being too liberal, at fault for the border crisis, and for being weird. Republicans are pivoting in their new election playbook that argues that Harris could be even better for down-ballot Republicans than Biden. The GOP plans to exploit the dynamic of Biden himself having doubted his VP's chances of beating Trump. Quote, it's important to remember the only real reason Joe Biden held on as long as he did by aggressively making the case that his vice president's an even worse candidate than him. The memo lays out how Republicans will shift their election strategy to run against Harris and alludes to polling shows the VP if not more unpopular than Joe Biden in every single competitive state. The theme throughout, Republicans will paint Harris as a radical progressive. She is, pointing to an old ranking of her as the most liberal senator, reminding voters of past pledges to ban fracking, which she has said numerous times, decriminalize illegal border crossings, and eliminate cash bail, among other things. Immigration is a first policy issue listed in the document. Republicans have long made Harris the person, the focal point for the record illegal border crossings after Biden charged her for addressing the root causes of migration back in 2021. She was the border czar. It's not Republicans who made her this. Joe Biden did. The memo also includes a weird category, mocking Harris's habit of laughing at the inappropriate moments, her self-proclaimed love of Venn diagrams, and her call to ban plastic straws, among other things. Republicans had been drooling over what they saw as an election landslide if Biden remained at the top of the Democrat ticket. One senior strategist described the sense of relief in GOP circles that the party seems to be coalescing around Harris rather than Democrat stars like Pennsylvania Governor Shapiro and Michigan Governor Gretchen Whitmer. On the app chat, David weighing in says, Chad, you were right earlier when you said that the Democrats have played this perfectly. If it had not been for that early debate, none of us would be talking about this right now. Instead, we'd be gearing up for the Democrat convention, and it would be Sleepy Joe at the head table. Yeah, no, absolutely. I mean, it is the Democrats really, and their friends in the media, played this perfectly. They wanted Joe out. They played the long game. They were hoping that Joe would absolutely blow up at the debate. CNN was in on it because CNN, they kept on showing Biden in the split picture was not a favor at all to Joe. I mean, they really, really did him some harm on that. And they were actually fairly nice, if you will, to Donald Trump and fair to Donald Trump during the debate. Again, I think more and more people are going to realize that this is all a setup here to get Kamala Harris installed, or at least to get some other Democrat installed other than Joe Biden. I think people will see that eventually. When we come back, your phone calls, your text messages, and we'll wrap things up.
The Chad Hastie Show can be heard all over West Texas, weekdays from 5 to 7 p.m. Tune in on News Talk 95.1 and 790 KFYO in Lubbock, News Talk 940 in Amarillo, News Talk 94.7 and 1470 KYYW in Abilene, and in Wichita Falls on News Talk 96.3 and 1290. The Chad Hastie Show. Make it a part of your drive home. Weekdays from 5 to 7 p.m.
Clay Travis and Buck Sexton.
Wednesday edition, Clay Travis, Buck Sexton Show. The Kamala Harris unbelievable presidential campaign is off and running. What is the latest? We will break it down for you. Plus, reports that Joe Biden will address the nation finally after a week's absence. Do we expect him to be able to or not? We will discuss all that more Wednesday edition, Clay and Buck.
Clay Travis and Buck Sexton, tomorrow morning at 11.
Love right now. Giving it up for your love.
on the Chad Hastie Show. Appreciate you tuning in. We had a couple of texts from yesterday that I didn't have time to get to. I want to bring them up. One texter, while Harris might technically be to the left of Biden, I'm not sure there's a functional difference. Not aware of anything too far left that Biden stopped or anything to the right that Biden allowed, which Harris could have stopped. Maybe I'm missing something, but I think almost any Democrat winning the presidency is equally awful compared to just about any other Democrat. And then same texture, I don't think it's wise for Republicans to call for Biden to step down before the election. Harris being the acting president, even for a short time, is likely to increase her poll number, at least in my unqualified opinion. Well, giving her the power of the presidency, she could make moves. There are things that she could do if she wanted to come across as someone who wants to be competent and show people, hey, here's the leadership I can really, you take me away from being VP and you let me really go for this. Here are some of the things I could do. And she could probably trick some people. So, yeah, no, I'm with you. It's Biden should probably resign, but it is definitely a double-edged sword. 806-680-2790. Story out of, where did I put this story? Here we go. CNN. Some of the latest on this would-be assassin. Pennsylvania State Police Commissioner revealing stunning details about the Trump shooting. Local law enforcement commissioner revealed during a House Homeland Security hearing on Tuesday, stunning new details about the security failures that led to the near assassination of Donald Trump, raising more questions for the embattled Secret Service. Pennsylvania State Police Commissioner Christopher Paris's striking testimony comes just one day after the now-resigned Secret Service Director Kimberly Cheadle testified before the House Oversight Committee and largely declined to answer questions about the shooting. Paris told lawmakers about the communication between the Secret Service and local law enforcement, who initially spotted Thomas Matthew Crooks, the would-be assassin. He also described a more detailed timeline when officers first spotted Crooks in the crowd when the 20-year-old opened fire on Trump. Two local law enforcement officers left a building with vantage points overlooking the roof where Crooks took aim at the former president before he fired shots, Paris testified. Paris also said the two officers with the Butler County Emergency Services Unit, a tactical force with sniper capabilities, left their post in the building to look for a suspicious individual they spotted first and alerted to other law enforcement. That person was Crooks. Lawmakers watched video taken by a congressional tour of the rally site Monday, where the building where the ESU officers left their post, showing the roof where Crooks eventually climbed and took shots at Trump. Republican Dan Bishop of North Carolina said, so you're saying, to your knowledge, those ESU officers left their location where they could look out the window in search of this person. Paris said, that's my understanding. Adding officers went searching with other local law enforcement officers in the area. Quote, I don't want to establish a timeline minute by minute because we don't have that yet. Bishop also questioned whether two officers who left their posts could have seen Crooks climb on top of the roof if they had stayed put. Paris said he did not know. Investigators now also believe that Crooks fired 8 rounds before he was killed by counter snipers. Paris told the committee, quote, I believe the number is 8. We have 8 casings that have been recovered. Officials had previously only confirmed that the shooter fired multiple times at the rally earlier this month. Paris told members of Congress that several Secret Service agents told the state police area commander during a walkthrough of that area before the rally that the Butler County Emergency Services Unit was responsible for securing the building where Crooks fired the shots. A municipal officer came face-to-face with Crooks during the several minutes the would-be assassin was on the roof before Crooks fired on Trump. Pierce said the brief confrontation came as the pair of local officers who had learned of Crooks' position on the roof attempted to climb up and confront the shooter, but the officer says the officer was dangling from the roof. Crooks aimed his rifle at the officer, and the officer fell. Pierce told lawmakers that Crooks was on the roof for roughly 3 minutes, correcting a shorter time frame that he gave earlier. But only a few seconds passed between when the officer confronted him and when he fired at the former president. Quote, when one of the local officers hoisted up the other one and subsequently fell, Crooks was, I believe, already close to being in his final position. I'm told it's, again, a sequence of events, not a timeline based on the prior criteria, but seconds after that is when the first shots rang out. Paris said that whether or when the confrontation was related to the Secret Service or other law enforcement agencies at the rally remains under investigation. So, again, just complete screw-ups. Just a complete failure of security. And again, you have to believe that this was just an utter failure. A complete and utter failure of security, or that something else is at play. And now the Secret Service warning Trump not to hold any outdoor rallies, which Trump is known for holding big outdoor rallies. Well, does that mean they've got information that Trump's life is at further risk? Enjoy the rest of your evening. Follow me on social media at Chad Hasty Radio. Be sure to go through and also download the podcast wherever you get your favorite podcast from. Enjoy your evening. Stay healthy. Stay safe. God bless you all. We'll see you back here tomorrow at 5.
The Chad Hasty Show, a presentation of the Texas Town Square Media Network. The views and opinions expressed during the Chad Hasty Show are not necessarily the views of this station staff, management, advertisers, or Town Square Media.